evening. Hope everyone has had a good week thus far. I pray that it's going well. This is some scripture that I believe I preached on not too long ago, but I've been studying back through it, and I've been studying on past it in different areas. And, you know, if I can find it, and help if I go to the right spot. Look, I even got it marked. 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians is going to be in chapter 11. We'll be in verses 23 through 33. And then there's a few more scriptures that we'll go to and look at in different spots. But you know, we as Christians, we might not have the same problems that those disciples had, per se, that we read about. Right? I mean, I don't think that we walk down the road and we get stoned. I don't think we walk down the road and get pulled into a jail and get whipped, right? I mean, I've not seen that here. Yes, it happens in other places. There's Christians that's been beheaded. There's Christians that have died for the cause of preaching the gospel. And that happens. Folks, that's life. In different areas, that is the life of a Christian. It happened to the ones that we read about in our scripture. You know, they lived and died for what they believed in. And you know, I think and I believe on Wednesday night to me is a night that we should learn that it's our core group of people that come together. I think it's a night that we can study together, we can talk together, but I think it should be a night of encouragement also. Why? Because it's the middle of the week. Listen, we was here Sunday. We had Sunday morning, Sunday night. Why is that so important? Because sometimes Mondays is horrible, right? We're starting to go back somewhere that we really don't want to be to start with, a lot of us. That's that bad word called work. Amen? I mean, we enjoy our jobs, but sometimes it's the same old thing. And then we go out, we leave here, and also what happens Monday is we walk out those doors and we go right back into the world that does not like us. Why? Because Satan controls it. That world out there, folks, that's his. And you know what? If he's not messing with us, we might ought to look at what we're doing. Because if we're not striving to do what the Lord wants us to do, guess what? Old Satan's set back and coasting and messing with somebody else that is. Amen? But I brought this back because this is Paul, and he was writing to the Corinthians. And in these verses, Paul talks some about what he went through. But all that he went through, do you believe it? None of that happened before he got struck down on the road. You believe that? All that Paul went through was after he accepted Jesus Christ as his Savior. And folks, that's what I want to encourage us about tonight. Listen, the Bible does not say when we accept Jesus Christ and everything's good, that we have eternal life. It did not say from there on it's going to be a bed of roses. You know why? Because you and I at that point have the Holy Spirit in us. And when we do something wrong, we should be convicted about it. And when we get convicted about it, guess what happens? You and I have to change. A person that does something in the world that keeps doing it every day, each and every day, day in and day out, guess what? They don't have to change. You know why? Because it don't bother them. They're doing what they do. But folks, if you and I do what we do, if Ben Britton does, if I walk out of my house in the morning and say, all right, I'm doing what I do today. Who won that day? It ain't God. Because I'm going to tell you, I'm a selfish individual. I am. If my boys come through my house, three boys, 16 to 10, and I'm sitting in my recliner, and I got my feet propped up, and I'm snoring like a big bear. And they all come through there hollering and screaming and wake Daddy up. Guess what? They get to see a big bear. Why? Because I'm selfish. All right? Paul, when Paul was struck down on that road, he was probably, and this is Ben Britton's opinion, to me, he was probably one of the most unselfish people from that point on. Because his goal was to get out to others and teach them and let them learn about what happened to him. Because he wanted them to have eternal life. And folks, that should be mine and your goal. As Bay Lake Missionary Baptist Church, that should be our goal. But guess what? It's hard. It's hard. Starting in verse 24. Starting in chapter 11, verse 24, 2 Corinthians, chapter 11, verse 24, it says, of the Jews, five times received I 40 stripes save one. Thrice was I beaten with rods, once was I stoned, thrice I suffered shipwreck, a night and a day I have been in the deep, in journeys often, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils by my own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness, besides those things that are without that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches. Who is weak? And I am not weak. Who is offended? And I burn not. If I must needs glory, I will glory of the things which concern mine infirmities. In the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is blessed for evermore, knoweth that I lie not. In Damascus, the governor, under Aretas, the king, kept the city of the Damascenes, with a garrison, desirous to apprehend me. And through a window in a basket was I let down by the wall and escaped his hands. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you again for allowing us to come into your house tonight, Lord. We thank you for the word that is printed, Lord, that we can have with us each and every day, Lord. I pray that you be with us, Lord, as we thrive through this world on your dime, Lord, on your time. Lord, I pray that you help us. I pray that we can go through this world as a Christian should, Lord, to uplift you and stand for what you are, to lead others to no place but to you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, and I pray that you just encourage each individual here, Lord, that you just lift them up and help them get through this week to return to your house, Lord, on Sunday, that we may be lifted up again. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. You see, in chapter 2, in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, starting there in verse 24, Paul was talking about what he went through. Could you imagine? Could you imagine? As soon as you surrendered to preach the gospel, to go out and lead others to Jesus Christ, the first place you went, people started hunting you down. Could you imagine that? Listen, for us to do the work of Christ, it will cost us. It will cost us. And you know, a lot of us will stop at that point. But tonight I want to encourage you to keep going. Listen, it may cost you today, but tomorrow, what you've done today is paid for. It may cost you tomorrow, but Saturday, what you've done on Friday, guess what? It's paid for. But I'm going to tell you this too. If we don't go the route that the Lord has set for us, it will cost you. And folks, that's a price that none of us want to pay. Because that's going to be a price standing before our Lord and looking at Him with no excuse, but yes, sir. Can you imagine that? You know, I think about missionaries that I've read about in the past. I was reading about a missionary today that I come across. Oh, he went to China. Started with an H, 1900s, I think. What was his name, Brother Sheila? You remember? Holloway? Anyway, and I'll try to get that name for you because you know how I am with names. We was talking about names tonight. But this missionary, his father passed away. He was a younger man. His father passed away. The Lord had laid on his heart as a calling to go as a missionary. And where he laid on his heart to go to was China. But for him to go, he had to tell his only family member that was left, which was his mother, goodbye. Now you think about that. Did it cost him something to go? Absolutely. It did. It cost him never seeing his mother again. Or it cost his mother for him to go. Because if she was his only surviving family member left, guess what? He was hers. Right? And she, it says in the story that I was reading, that she met him on the ship. She went in and straightened his bed up, the little cabin on the ship that he was going to be in, because it was going to take him 6 months to get there in that day and age on the ship. And she straightened his bed up and said she grabbed his hand, knelt down beside the bed and prayed with him and asked the Lord to take care of him because she wasn't going to be able to. So what I'm saying is sometimes our sacrifices go beyond us. But it's okay because God will take care of us. You know, a lot of times we start weighing things. Listen, I'm the world's worst of it. When the Lord called me into mission work, I said, no way, ain't happening. And I started weighing things. Let me tell you, the blessings overcome the sacrifices. And they do that in an everyday life. Will sacrifices hurt? Absolutely. But listen, when that one person steps up and accepts Jesus Christ as their Savior, and you know that one person, just one, is not dying and going to hell anymore, folks, it's worth it. Paul said that. Paul strived through what all he had done, all that had happened to him. If you get over in chapter 12, it says in verse 10, in same 2 Corinthians, it says in chapter 12, verse 10, therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses, for what? For Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong. Why? Because, folks, when we're at our down point, when we're at the very bottom and Ben Britton can't go no more, Lord, I cannot do it, that's when I'm the strongest. You know why? Because I'm dependent on Him. And there's no end to that. Listen, He loved us enough that He sent whom? His Son. Folks, if He loved us enough to send His Son, listen, He ain't going to quit on you when it's fourth down and you're at the goal line. He ain't quitting on you. He's going to build everybody back up and He's going to get you on through. Yeah, it's a struggle. Sometimes it hurts. Sometimes we're in pain. Sometimes we would rather not do it. But folks, the victory, oh, it's good. And that victory is seeing another soul saved. That's what we strive for. You and I. Each and every day, by the way we walk, by the way we talk, by what we do, act, whatever you want to put in there, we do that for the sake of one person getting saved. Listen, I flew in airplanes. I left Joaquin, Texas. I'm a little country boy. I'm not leaving Joaquin, Texas. You know why I went? To see one person get saved. That was my goal. And listen, I may not have got to see it then, but that church building that we built, wherever it was, folks, that's just a tool. This building right here, this is just a tool. Listen to me, the church is the one sitting in the pews. But you go and do it. Why? For the opportunity for them to use that tool and one person be saved. How excited was y'all Sunday? Two people followed Jesus Christ in scriptural baptism. Amen? Two people joined our church Sunday, folks. That's the goal. That's the outcome of doing what we're supposed to be doing. But it gets hard. Paul said, as many things that I've gone through, he was telling the Corinthians, listen, it's going to happen. It's going to hurt. Just keep going. He told Timothy, endure it. He told Titus, keep going. One foot in front of the other. You was right. He said, y'all was raised in the gospel. I've taught you everything I can teach you. I've walked with you. I was the same inside and outside. I was the same in that county as I was in this county. You can ask anybody. Why? Because he had that reputation to hold up. Not for Paul's sake, for Christ's sake. Folks, you and I have that same reputation. Not for my sake, but for Christ's sake. In Galatians 6, in verse 17. Galatians 6 and verse 17, it says this. From henceforth let no man trouble me, for I bear in my own body the marks of the Lord Jesus. That was Paul writing. And he said, from henceforth let no man trouble me, for I bear the marks of my Lord Jesus Christ. Okay? What do you mean by that? He said, listen, I'm doing this for that guy. The man upstairs, not anybody else. That's why he said, let no man trouble him. Not that burdens wasn't on him. Not that he met people that said, oh, Paul, you almost convinced me. You remember that? You've almost convinced me to love the Lord Jesus Christ as my Savior. Did that stop Paul? No. You know why? Because he planted the word and he took one step and kept on going. It wasn't his job to save them. Folks, it's not our job to save people. That's another hard part. A lot of times the Lord uses us just to plant a seed. A dear friend of mine that I love dearly, he's an associate pastor in Monroe, Louisiana. And he went to get a haircut here a while back. And the place was full. He couldn't get a haircut, so he went to another spot because he had something that was going on, and his wife told him he needed a haircut, right? So he wasn't going home without it. He went to another spot, and he wasn't happy to be there. He didn't know. But the lady started talking to him, and he started visiting with her. She was cutting his hair, and guess what? It ended up on a conversation about Jesus Christ. And she was driving 40 miles to go to a church. So she wasn't making it all the time, but she was making it when she could. Does that sound familiar? And my friend was talking to her about his church, which was ended up being like 5 miles down the road from where she lives. So they talked, they had visited, and he left. And you think, well, he was just in there, and he's a pastor, and that's what he's supposed to do. Yes, it is, but he done it. You see, that's the difference. Well, the other day, he's in seminary in Minden, Louisiana, and he said there was a young man that was standing up and giving a testimony, and he was talking about, he stopped at this place to get a haircut because it said walk-ins welcome. And he was visiting with the lady cutting his hair. And she was talking about this and that and how things are bad. She can't get to church all the time because she's got to drive so far away. And the young man looked at her and said, you know there's a church right here. And she said, yes, it's Hyde Park. I've been meaning to go by there. And he said, man, I got a good friend that I'm in seminary with, and he's the associate pastor there. And she says, you know, I think I met him. But after two people have told me that, I think I'll go this Sunday. Folks, it ain't about tomorrow. It's about the outcome when God wants it to happen. Okay? We'll focus on something small. We'll focus on something that is right there. And if it don't happen, we get upset about it. Right? Listen, the first months when I surrendered to preach, the Lord blessed me with going several different places. And I would go places and see people preach, and I would see one up to 20 people hit the altar. That's awesome. Okay? For several months, I preached and I preached and I preached and I preached, and nobody come forward. And listen, I'm a pretty prideful guy, all right? And I talked to the Lord about it. Lord, listen, if this is what you want me to do, how come nothing's happening? Am I doing what I'm supposed to? Lord, I'm praying about these messages. I'm praying that you send me where you want to send me. I'm praying that I preach where you want me to preach, but nothing's happening. And you know what I started studying? The Old Testament. And you know, for 400 years, them boys sacrificed. You read about the prophets in the Old Testament where they come out of the sewers and went up to the kings to tell them what was going on because they lived in the sewers. Folks, I started looking at myself real hard and real close and thinking, man, I have nothing to complain about. And I sat down on my knees one night and I prayed to the Lord and I said, Lord, I understand. It's not about me. It's about you. And you know what happened the very next service I preached? There's a young lady walked the aisle, pulled me to the side, and accepted Jesus Christ as her Savior. Folks, that had nothing to do with me. It was all God. He was saying, Ben, endure. You keep going. It's not about you. It's about me. And when we get that, guess what? Those problems that we have, those problems that I guarantee you, as a Christian, you're going to have, when he's right beside us, they ain't near as big as what we think they are. If we'll keep him there, if we'll keep going for Jesus Christ, those problems go away. Each of us have them. Philippians 3. Verses 10 through 12 says this, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings being made comfortable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Jesus Christ. Again, Paul was saying, not me. Folks, this is not for me. It's for Jesus Christ. Listen, I encourage you, as hard as it is, this is not for us. It's for Jesus Christ. The one that gave his son for each and every one of us. Can you imagine? I told you the story about the missionary that kissed his mother bye. Getting on a ship to go to China, knowing he'd never see her again. A young man. Folks, listen, I'm 38 years old. So I'm still a young man, I think. I'm midway anyway. When I kissed my mom bye to come to Florida, it was tough. And I can call her every day. I can see her. It's only 14 hours. Folks, we got vehicles, we got airplanes. Guess what? I'm not held away from her. This man kissed his mom bye to get on a ship to go to China, knowing he would never see her again. She kissed her son bye to get on a ship to go to China, knowing she would never see him again. What do we sacrifice? The Lord sacrificed his son. That he gave his only begotten son. Why? Because God so loved the world. We got nothing on that, right? We got nothing on that. One more scripture. 1 Corinthians 9. 1 Corinthians 9, verses 22. And it says, to the weak became I as weak, that I might gain the weak. I made all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. And this I do for the gospel's sake, that I might be a partaker thereof with you. Paul said, all of this, I do it for the gospel's sake. Folks, I know each and every one in here has faced hardships from being a Christian. There's things going on in your lives right now that are happening because you're a Christian. So do we stop or do we keep going? Paul said, I do it all, not for me, but for the sake of the gospel. And I want to encourage each and every one of you, listen, do it all for the sake of the gospel. You don't do it for Brother Sheely. You don't do it for Brother Ben or your aunts or your uncles. You do it for the sake of the gospel. Not for Bay Lake Church. Not for your gain, but for the sake of the gospel. And I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you to keep that the forefront. Keep that the thought in the front. Why? Because the world's tough. But you and I have the best partner we can have. And that's Jesus Christ. Now,